Tawhid means unification. It doesn't mean oneness. And of course, Muslims do not worship one God. They are the biggest polytheists on the planet.
So your God is the bloody God, Dracula. He have no mercy.
So you worship a different God?
Is that
what you're saying?
Yes.
Oh.
I am here defending
your false God.
Defending my God and your true God. And this is for
what you got.
What he said about the Quran, this is three God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So you have seven gods now.
Is our salvation, and as I believe as a Muslim, the oneness is the eternal life, as Jesus, peace upon him, referred to in his teaching. I will mention then as the Old Testimony, we know
Testament.
I know that maybe my accent and my English is a little bit as perfect, even I was 26 years here. So I'm sorry if somebody misunderstand me or I pronounce something in the wrong way. Please feel free to correct me whenever you feel I need to.
Yep.
And let's start with the Old Testament. Which bring us to the oneness of God, which, as I believe, it contradicts the New Testament, and to confirm it, Jesus, peace upon him, is the greatest commandment he teach everyone.
Can I just intercede for one moment? You're not going to talk about the Quran.
The Quran, we know that we as a Muslim, we worship only one God, and the Quran teach that God would forgive any sin, no matter how big. There's only if anyone associate any partner or any God alongside him or any son or anything, this will be our downhill straight to hell. It's offending to God to give to him a son or a partner or a wife, or say that he incarnated and his creation to save them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, you can open any Arabic Bible and you will find in Genesis 1:31, the word Allah mentioned 31 times. And Arabic and the Jew, they know that the word Allah is the creator, okay. Is the only God.
This is a very important thing. You said you're going to preach us about the oneness. Now what I'm hearing, you're doing what Evangelist Lamin does.
Okay.
You're trying to teach me my Bible.
Right.
So one of the good things I have today is an Arabic New Testament.
Fair enough.
So I'm going to let you open to 1 John, 1 Epistle of John 2:22. If you can read Arabic, you should be able to locate this.
Okay. First, I sense that when I said Allah in Genesis, I guess you have a problem with the name Allah.
And no.
Do you agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the God of all of us?
No.
Fair enough.
I don't.
Okay, my question, why then we find it in Genesis 31 times
I would like us to go in a tandem. What you're trying to do is teach me the biblical aspect. But I'm an evangelist, I'm a teacher of the gospel.
Okay.
So what you're trying to do for me is actually, you're not doing dawah. You're trying to teach me Christianity from an Islamic perspective, which is inaccurate.
Okay.
So what I need to do is, first of all, you said the oneness of Allah, or who you call God, is the way of salvation. That is what you're trying to say.
Okay.
So what I was expecting to hear from you as a counter argument was your Tawhid, what Tawhid is. So you've spoken about the unity. So now I'm going to first of all preach what our mode of salvation is. And this is why I'll go to Romans chapter 10, verses 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Now you first of all said that you don't believe in the incarnation of the Lord. For with the heart believeth man unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So by me confessing that Jesus Christ is the Christ, Christ means Christos, which is Messiah in Hebrew. Now the Messiah means God in the flesh. Now if you look at Malachi 3:1, and I got a little look at your notes, you had Malachi 3:6. Malachi 3:1, the Lord tells Prophet Malachi that he's coming to his temple in Jerusalem. So this is actually one of the prophecies of the Bible being fulfilled. God is coming to his temple. Now you do not agree that God died for his sins on the cross. I know this because the Islamic doctrine, Surah 4, 157, goes against this. Now, you're trying to tell us that Allah is God, that we shouldn't associate partners, and that you're in a Taweed. So now I want you to explain this Taweed so we can tackle that issue before we go into you doing the biblical. So I'll make this very simple. Tackle the Taweed. What is this Taweed you're talking about?
Yes. When I mention Jesus, peace upon him, and he teaches us what the eternal life according to Jesus. First, you go to John 12, 49-50, the eternal life that you
Can I, sorry, I don't like interceding with people, but I will engage you again. I would like you to please explain to the audience this Taweed you're mentioning. Because
Jesus,
the audience, we'll go into the gospel, don't worry, we have time. And we'll go into the Quran. But first of all, I want you to make a statement to the audience. What some people watching have never heard of Islam. Yeah. They do not know what you believe in. And you're preaching the gospel when you're already inaccurate. So please explain Taweed as a doctrine. That is what I would love you to do.
As I didn't interrupt you, I would like as well that when I talk, you don't interrupt me. Besides, I'm responding to what you introduce yourself with. And our conversation here, it contained about the oneness of God, which is related to the salvation. And I'm giving you from Christ how he direct us straight away to the eternal life, which you and me are seeking. Besides, when I talk about what I talk about, I realize that you said some two things. That Messiah, let me ask you again, what does that mean, Messiah?
What is the Messiah?
Yeah.
Messiah means the God in the flesh. If we go to Isaiah, like I said, we're going to get caught up. Let's start with the Taweed. Let's deal with the Taweed, then we'll go into that. We did agree with this before we... because you called me online. You got my username, and you asked me to do this debate. So let's be fair. We've come out. So please, let's start. Tell us what this oneness of Taweed is. So we don't have flight at all. Because I see you got a lot of preparation here, but you don't have an understanding of the gospel. So let's make this very simple so that the audience can understand where we're coming across. So let's deal with the Taweed and I will go.
With due respect, this is the second time when you're addressing me, you're accusing me of not understanding what I'm talking about.
No, I did not say that. I said address the Taweed for the audience.
I'm addressing what you said, and that's why I ask you, Messiah, and you said God and the flesh. And the Messiah is the word Al-Masih. Al-Masih, that the one who wrapped things.
Anointed. I know, it's Fatwa 11686.
And it's not...
It's flat-footed, anointed, and it's truthful. That is the Islamic Fatwa.
I don't want to get involved, but I do want to ask one thing.
I don't belong to any Dawah team. Because I always come by myself and I talk by myself. I don't belong to anyone. I don't follow anyone. This is my search by myself, and I debate the way I understand things. And I might be wrong, but I'm not wrong because I study to accept the truth. Regarding the brother, when he came to address, he goes to Roman, which is Paul. Paul is the one who actually destroyed all the teaching of Christ, all the teaching of Christ by the blood of Christ. And he
How can he destroy the teachings of Christ with the blood of Christ? Okay, yeah. 1 second.
I didn't finish.
I know.
I didn't finish.
I will finish this one.
What
did we agree with? Sorry. I don't like interrupting people, but I have to talk
for the audience.
I'm thinking of the audience.
I'm giving you.
It is not. I could have a kind of debate with you that will go off tangent. But you promised me we'll focus on Tawheed and salvation.
Yeah,
so I don't want you. I want you to talk about the Islamic narrative of Tawheed and. This is very simple, sir.
Let me. I want you to defend
Islam, not to If you want to do this. I'll just drop the script and say that you don't believe in one God. You believe in four gods. You got the Kaaba stone. You worship and you go. And then you also got the eternal Quran that's either created or uncreated. Then I can go that you worship Muhammad because Allah and his angels pray to Muhammad. Then I can go into, again, the Kaaba stone.
So
I can go into Jibril being the Lord of Muhammad. Yeah. 53 verse 10. So like I said, let's start again and concentrate
let's focus
on Tawheed.
Yeah.
Let's focus.
Okay. So we go on. I'm not going to answer all of this because there's
so many
subjects.
You don't need to answer. I'd like you to go into Tawheed.
The Old Testament it teach that God, He don't change His nature. I don't know why you're laughing while I'm showing you respect and I'm giving you
what we're talking about. Yeah, yeah.
Let's get to your camera.
The whole world is seeing you. You're representing Islam. You're not an evangelist.
God is immortal, eternal, and invisible. So this three attributes.
Oh, so you believe in the Trinity now?
Can you please let me finish? This three attribute of God, it doesn't change, because your Bible confirm it, and Malachi 3:6, God doesn't change His nature. God is the living and everlasting. Habakkuk 1:12. The God remains the same in nature. Hebrew. Isaiah 40:28. Lord, everlasting God, He will not grow tired or weary.
So what has this got to do with Tawheed?
Can I finish? And this is exactly Tawheed. This is the oneness of God according to your Bible.
I'm talking about the Quran. We believe in one God. Christians believe in one God.
When I finish, I will ask you to. Please let me state.
What we're going to have to do.
You have to listen to me. When I finish, I will come back to you.
Yes.
And I will respect you if you show some respect.
I am showing you respect.
Can I do some timing?
But the point is, yes. I will time it.
Isaiah, as of now, yes?
Isaiah 45, 5.
3 minutes.
Lord, no other. God, none beside me. So God, no one is beside Him. No other God.
3 minutes.
Isaiah 46, 9. I am God and there's no other. There's none like me. And we know that Jesus is like any of us. Jesus is mortal. Has beginning, has an end, and He's visible. God is invisible, and John teaches us God is a spirit, and God, no one seen God or can see God. As well, Numbers 23:19, God is not a man. We go to Psalm 102:27, but you remain the same. God remains the same. God doesn't change. Jesus, peace upon Him. He was in the womb. He was a boy. He was a teenager. He's changing. And He will die and grow old and weary. God, there's no one like God, because there's no one have seen God. Up to you, please.
Okay, so this is the problem we have when we try and counter the Dawah. Anybody that wants to preach Islam and the oneness and the uniqueness of God. Now, every Christian believes in one God. I don't really need to make a statement. What I find disappointing is that when I get a Muslim to try and get into dialogue that requested me online to challenge him to a debate in Speaker's Corner, and I've gone out of my way to entertain this, and he told me at the beginning of the conversation he's going to focus on Tawheed and salvation.
Ah, okay.
Now, I've given him this his chance because he said I'm disrespectful. One of the things with Yayo, and this is why I've given him audience, while I'll heckle some other Muslims, he does have a nice personality. He doesn't, he's non-threatening. But there's a point that we have to get this conversation on a direction. I don't need him to preach the Bible. You will not understand the Bible if you don't have the Spirit of the Lord as guidance. So any Muslim trying to use the Bible as a guidance is committing blasphemy. He's removing from the words of the Lord. If you look at the last chapter of Revelation, it warns that anybody that removes words from the biblical narrative will meet the plagues in the afterlife when you are condemned to eternal damnation. So now I'll get onto this oneness of what, because he doesn't want to explain the Islamic narrative, I'm going to explain it from what I've gathered from my learning and the exegesis of Islam. Tawhid means unification. It doesn't mean oneness. And of course, Muslims do not worship one God. They are the biggest polytheists on the planet. And this is one of the things that I was hoping to express. Now, he's going to try and tackle the biblical aspect, but I can prove that Islam has more than one God. Talk to a Muslim. Is the Quran created or uncreated? Some would say it's created. Some would say it's uncreated. If it's uncreated, that means it's eternal. The Quran is going to testify on Judgment Day. That makes it divine. So that is one of the gods of Islam. So now, when we say unification, that's the first god in the unification. Now, they also pray to Muhammad. Muhammad is dead in the bones. We know this, and he's buried in a grave. But Muslims pray the fish, Allah, and they bless. Now, thanks to Muhammad Hijab, and we'll continue calling Muhammad Hijab's name for ensuring that the rest of the world, through your arrogance, contacting David Wood online, having no respect, and because of your arrogance, you've revealed to the world that your god, which is a fake pagan moon god, prays to Muhammad. So that's your second god of Islam. Now the third god is Allah. Allah that no one has seen, but somehow Muhammad went in Surah 17:1 to the seven heavens, and he somehow got the prayers knocked down from 50 to 5, even though he didn't see Allah. So how does that happen? A contradiction in the Quran and the exegesis from the tafsir. But we know Allah is one of the gods. Now we have the right hand of Allah. This is another god. It's the Kaaba stone, the black stone in the Kaaba, a temple that is supposed to be significant with a temple in Jannah. Yeah, this is four gods we've identified. Now the Kaaba can relieve you from sin. If something can take away your sin and is venerated, and worshipped, that makes it a god. So we getting all these four together, for me as a layman looking at Islam, that is the unification, the Tawhid of the four pagan moon gods. But if I go to Surah 53 and I say, have you considered Alat al-Uzza al-Manat, the exalted cranes? Who? Now, those are other gods. The intercession. Now, the Quran says that Allah's word is the Quran. So that means it's Allah saying those words to the audience. Otherwise, it's the words of Muhammad. So somehow in the book of Allah, Muhammad's words are there. So that means Muhammad is your God as well. So there's many ways of arguing it, because if you look at the first, third, and second person views of the Quran reading, it shows. So now your Tawhid, as you were mentioning, you are polytheist. You are not actually talking about oneness. So thank you for clarifying that we in the Bible, we believe in one God, and for proving that in you, in your Quran, you believe in four gods or five gods, if we take in. So do you have an answer to that?
Of course, I have an answer. First, I would like you not to mention Muhammad Hijab or anybody else, because they are not me.
I'm using citation. Muhammad's not here, but I use Muhammad's word.
This is backbiting, because the guy is not here to defend himself. So I apologize about that. We have, for me, I respect all the brothers, and if there is an issue between you and Muhammad Hijab, please sort it out.
I don't have an issue. I'm using the citation.
Again, you accuse me of dawah, and I already mentioned that I don't belong to any dawah.
No, I said dawah. Dawah means invitation to Islam.
Yeah,
I'm using it from that word, the word. I'm not saying you're a member of EFC dawah.
Yeah.
No, I did not say that. I said dawah.
Yeah. Okay.
So now, I'm right in
let's
that context.
Let's come back to the oneness of God according to the Bible and according to Quran. What he said about the Quran, this is three God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So you have seven gods now.
Very funny. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he answered straight away. In hiya illa asma'un sammaytum wa ha antum wa abakum ma anzallahu allahu biha min sultan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, those idols, they are but names, you give it to those idols, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he have no partner and nothing. And you mentioned Al-Kaaba. Al-Kaaba, it unite all the Muslim into one destination to worship Almighty God. There's only one God.
So you worship the one God from that building. Is that what's correct?
The building is just destination to unite the Muslim to worship.
Destination, sir. I just want to ask you to clarify.
Is
destination.
Okay. Is a destination to unite the Muslim and to worship in only one God.
Okay. So what
and
is the stone there for, if it's the one God?
The stone,
yes.
As I know, yes. That stone, when Adam, peace be upon him, descend was descending from paradise, he took the stone and he was wiping his tears with it, and he kept it with it.
So that's an object. You are worshiping an object.
Again, we don't worship an object. We worship Almighty God who created heaven.
So why do you kiss
heaven.
The stone?
Kissing the stone is nothing but
to take your sins away.
No, it doesn't take the sin, because
it doesn't take the sin.
It doesn't take the sin. With taking the sin, we need to repent with sincerity, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive our sins.
So why do you do Hajj?
We do Hajj as an obedience to Almighty God. And
so why do you kiss the stone at the end of the Hajj?
You kiss it or you don't kiss it, it doesn't matter. You don't have to kiss it if you're not able. If you want to kiss it, you kiss it.
So why do you
Omar,
kiss it?
The Prophet kiss it because it's a stone from paradise. But he did it. We don't worship the stone. We worship the God of all heaven and
can
earth.
Can I answer you on this? There's a hadith saying in the Arab times, that I don't know the number of head. Okay. We used to worship stones. And when we found a new stone or a better stone, we'll milk over it with the sheep, and then we'll worship that stone. Okay. So the idol worship and the stone worship existed in pre-Arabia.
Okay.
So I would say that you have continued that idol tradition.
Let me answer. The Prophet, peace upon him, when he entered Mecca with 10,000 victorious, he destroyed all the idols with 360 idols.
So the Kaaba was an idol place.
I didn't interrupt, so have some patience.
I'm learning.
I'm answering. Let me finish, then you can ask.
Sorry, go ahead.
The Prophet, he destroyed all the idols in Mecca, and we go to worship the invisible eternal God
in a building.
The building is not but a square to unite all the Muslims around the world to worship Almighty God.
Do you know what worship means, sir?
Worship is to submit with all your heart or your soul to the Creator who created us. And to worship him is to fall
to bow to a stone.
To bow on the ground to worship Almighty God with Jesus.
But Almighty God is up there. If you bow to the ground, how are you worshiping Almighty God there?
Well, ask Jesus why he fall on his face to worship Almighty God.
I'll answer Jesus.
You interrupt me.
No, sorry.
And
you are rude.
I'm telling you.
You know why?
You are rude
because
every time I'm talking, I'm not upset.
I'm trying to help you with your dialogue. I'm giving you a constructive argument. I am actually helping you. You can see I'm giving you a constructive argument.
I'm begging you to let me finish my sentence.
Because you have to ask.
You're talking over me. I'm telling you, I will zip when I finish. Jesus, peace upon him, teach us when you want to pray to our God, go to your room and close your door and worship the unseen God who art in heaven. He didn't say who art on earth, me. He referred to him. And Jesus teach us in John 17:3, the true God is the only God who are there, whom he sent, Jesus Christ, to the lost sheep of Israel. And Jesus, peace upon him, tell me if I'm wrong. Jesus
teach. You have totally turned the narrative. You said tell me if I'm wrong. Or you've totally turned the narrative. Because what we were focusing on, because what I'm trying to do is actually help the audience to understand Islam.
But
you're just teaching a wrong version of Christianity.
The audience,
the audience are mostly Christian. They know their scripture. That's the problem. But they know you're wrong, and I don't want them to. I want them to understand Islam, not Christianity. I will give Christianity. The thing about the gospel. This is the funny thing with the gospel. I can read three verses of the Bible and I'll give you the gospel in just three verses.
Okay.
So all the things you're quoting are out of context. So what I'm trying to
Jesus
get
didn't
you,
didn't
you don't know what Jesus said because you're preaching
I don't
a false
know.
Jesus. No, because...
So didn't Jesus in John 17, 3 give you who is what is the eternal life and which was God, the true, the only true God, who He is, the Father in heaven, who's unseen. And didn't He say about Himself that He being sent by Almighty God? And do you disagree with me that He said, I've been sent only to the lost sheep of Israel? He commanded His apostle, don't go to Gentiles or Samaria, go rather to the
okay, lost John 17:3.
Okay.
Now I'm going to help this guy, brother.
Help yourself.
No, I'm going to help Yahya.
Misquoting a scripture.
It said John 17:3, and this is one of the sad verses that the Muslims use to make their case. But you just need to read verse 1 before you get to 3. And this is how it goes. Those words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh. So this is the Father given the Son, Father over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. So this is Jesus giving eternal. So we get to verse 3, what he said. And this is the eternal, this is the life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou givest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had before the world was. So now he has used a Christian argument to try and say that Jesus was glorifying the Father, but now Jesus is saying, bring me back up to earth, Father, because Jesus is the Word of God in the flesh. So that is the understanding, and this is why I said I'll prefer you to stick with the Islamic narrative and not entertain the Christian Bible to the Christian audience, because they have a better understanding of the scripture than you do. You are reading the Bible, looking at it from verse, without looking at the exegesis or the context. These are the words that Jesus spoke. So you actually believe these are the words of Jesus, but you're not even reading the context of the words.
Okay. May I?
I've stopped.
So Jesus, peace upon him, he... He teach us that the true, the only true God is the who art in heaven, not on earth. So Jesus wasn't God when he spoke about this. And Jesus will be seated on the right hand side of the mighty one, the true God. Which, as I remind you in Isaiah, the only God, he have no God beside him or before him. So Jesus is the mortal Jesus, will be seated by Almighty God, glorify him. And what glorification you're talking about, when he was brutally crucified and beaten.
Glory to God, a Muslim has said a crucifixion. Thank you. That's why I love this guy.
Where does he glorify him when he was brutally humiliated? For to him to die, so the father you're claiming is most merciful and most loving and all forgiver, and now the father he wants the blood of his son to forgive. He couldn't forgive for free, but he wants a price for to forgive the sin. So his the mercy and the justice of God is not there anymore, because your God is. He want the blood, and he want price. So he's a blood trader, which more offensive for God, as you see. And something else I would like to come to. if you do comparison between the beginning of John and the beginning of Genesis, you will see the biggest lie as the word become before God. If you can read, please, John 1.
When
John
you
one.
Finish your script.
I finish.
Now, I will go in, and this is the last thing. What Yahya doesn't understand is the hypostatic union, which is that Jesus, being fully God, was fully man. And he lowered himself to a servant so that he unlowered himself below angels. Now, it is to teach us as Christians humility and understanding that the Lord Jesus had to die on the cross. But I'm going to read the Gospel of John and I'm going to go into Revelations just to clarify one of the points, and then I'm going to get this debate back on the real topic, which it is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him nothing, not anything made that was made. Now if you go to verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So this is Jesus manifesting in the flesh. Now I'll go into Revelation, because he made one critical statement. He's saying that Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. And this is where illiteracy in the Islamic world comes in. The lack of knowledge of what an allegory is and a metaphor. When we say Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, this does not mean that there's three thrones, there's only one throne. And this is why I'm going to go into Revelations to prove this point and then go into what being seated at the right hand of the Father means. And this is the words of Jesus, Revelation chapter 1 verse 11. I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou hast seen, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia. Unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. So this is Jesus in heaven saying, I am the Alpha and Omega. Now, where do Muslims get this problem? That Jesus was seated at the right hand of the Father. Now, that allegory means the right hand of authority. This is something that is very easy to check up. You need to just do some Burian study. You need to just Google, what does Jesus mean when he says, I'm seated at the right hand of the Father? Now, Jehovah's Witnesses have caused a lot of these problems, and other Christian sects that are not Christian. They have deciphered as kind of attitude that there are three thrones in heaven, one for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Spirit. The Quran says that Mary is one of the gods of Christianity, Allah is one of the gods, and Isa is one of the gods. So Muslims believe that we believe in three gods. Why? Because Muhammad was a false prophet. Muhammad did not understand the Trinity, the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. The Bible is very clear that Jesus is the Word of God that manifests in the flesh, and this can see in John chapter 1. But now I'm going to cut that chase and go back. We have been here for a certain amount of time, I'm not sure how long. He has refused to address what Tawheed means. He has not even given me the Arabic meaning of the unity. Yahya has not answered anything. All he's done is trying to go into the Bible to put us on the back foot. But now I'm going to say, and get basically simple, Muslims are the ones that are polytheists. They don't even understand the Bible because they don't have the Spirit of the Lord to give them direction. They use the Bible to try and contradict the biblical message. The Bible message is simple. Just like the Shema of Israel, our Lord is one. We believe in one God. We don't believe in three gods. We believe in one God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit.
You just mentioned three gods.
Now, he said, I mentioned three gods, but there's one title for God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You can say it different if you look at the Apostle John. God the Father, God the Word, God the Spirit. Now that is one God. God can come as a form of his Spirit. That's how the Spirit of God roamed over the earth, as we see in Genesis 1. But this guy's trying to get us into a Trinity debate when we're talking about Tawheed,
yes.
The oneness and the salvation.
Actually, what's the
what is the salvation in Islam? We've had enough time to discuss the Bible. Now I want you to discuss and tell us, what
salvation.
Is this Tawheed? What is this?
I'm going to answer you, then we go to you.
It's about 30 minutes and you haven't addressed Tawheed, my friend.
We
got enough batteries and it's very cold.
No, my friend, no.
Yeah, we dictate it. We are going to come here, so I'm going to be
if you're not going to hit the point, then I'm going to knock.
Genesis
again, bro.
There's no mentioning for the word at all. And as I mentioned in John, there's the word the Word became before even God exists. And then the Word was with God. Then the Word was God. And this is responding to you for the Omega and the other one, whatever.
Alpha.
The
beginning
Alpha
and the end.
The Omega.
God is eternal.
The titles that Allah stole from Jesus.
I would like to respond as well.
You have a problem with comprehension. Yeah, that is why you're not understanding.
When Jesus said the Lord our God is one, he didn't teach incarnation.
I was talking about the Shema of Moses.
Let me finish. He didn't teach Trinity. There's the God, Father and Son and the Holy Spirit.
Yes, he did. He said, baptize the nations in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That is what Jesus said. You're wrong, sir.
You're wrong again, Jahia.
Please, stick to your Quranic narrative.
I'm going to stick. If he said so, that means he confused us and he lied.
He did not confuse us. You confused yourself.
When he said, Allah is confusing you, Yahya.
Allah is lying.
Allah is confusing you, Yahya.
Allow me to finish, please. When he said, the Lord our God is one, and another after the resurrection, he said, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. He'll bring a Trinity. That means he's contradicting himself and he's confusing us. You're Jesus.
When Jesus was baptized, a voice from heaven cried out, like, this is my son who will please.
I would like to say in Mark 13,
so again,
Mark
not
13, 5,
no, carry
6,
home with the Bible.
You're going
and
on.
Mark 14, 61, 62. Okay. Can you please read one of them? Can you please read one of them? Jesus said, there will be many coming in my name, claiming I am he, but and they will deceive many. Jesus teaching you, there will be many coming in my name, Jesus' name, and will deceive many, claiming that I am he, and he's not he.
Can I read the scripture?
God is not Jesus.
Matthew chapter 24,
Jesus
verse 4.
Prayed to God, but God the Father didn't pray to Jesus. God didn't pray to Jesus, but Jesus prayed to God.
Yeah.
Jesus said, I can do nothing of myself.
Jackie, are you going to talk about salvation according to Islam or no, my friend?
Yeah, I according to you.
According to Islam.
The salvation according to Islam is very simple.
Okay, go ahead.
Worship only one God and don't associate any God with him. And this finished.
So we've taken 13 minutes to, and this is the problem. This is a long suffering that we've been taught. We preach about our
if you
Bible.
Are suffering,
hold
I'm
on.
Not suffering
hold
at all.
Hold on, sir. Can I?
It's a pleasure
I didn't interrupt
me.
You. I was actually give you. It's a pleasure for him to see our long suffering. There you go. This is the fantastic. Yahya has unfortunately not addressed the topic the way we decided. We talked about Tawheed and the salvation according to Islam.
Tawheed.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I don't speak Arabic, and it's good that you actually interrupted me so that I don't get my script across. But my script was very simple. I've had an evangelist mission that is totally inaccurate of the Bible from a Muslim that is supposed to be doing dawah invitation. He took just a few seconds to explain what Tawheed. Now, Tawheed means unification, and it's a unification of the four pagan gods of Islam, or probably seven if you add Alat, Al-Uzza, and Manat. Now, the problem with your scope of the conversation you had is that you're totally misinterpreting the Bible in a way that anybody that read the few verses before and behind. And I'll go to Matthew chapter 24 just to show you how wrong you are. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear wars and rumors of wars. And ye be not troubled, for all these things will come to pass, but the end is not yet. Now, he was talking about the false Jesus, like the Quran is preaching. The Isa, the false Jesus that speaks from the cradle. The false Jesus that gets whisked up to air, that doesn't go through the crucifixion. Now, the point was salvation, and this is the essential point of Christianity. And I think this will be the best way to close this chapter, because we've tried to be rational in dialogue and it didn't work. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Why do we as Christians have to acknowledge who Jesus Christ is? Why do we spend time coming to these Muslims, engaging in the long suffering? No, they don't want to hear what we're saying. They read the Bible and have no idea of what it's talking about. Jesus on the Garden of Gethsemane, and this guy said Jesus worshipped Allah, which Jesus did not. Jesus fell down. Why? Because Jesus knew the head of the task and the pain and the long suffering that he was going to endure for the sin of mankind. Now Jesus had to die on the cross to swallow up death and hell, to take them and to destroy Satan's works. To die on the cross, and the blood shed on the cross was for our sins. Now those of us that have called ourselves Christians, that have accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, our salvation was paid by Jesus' selfless act on the cross. The pain and suffering, that death, that brokenness, that sadness, that despair, the total separation from the Father from that period that he had to spend the 3 days defeating the works of Satan. Now when the Christ resurrected with new raiment and in glory and came to his disciples, and Thomas doubted that the Lord God had risen from the dead, and he said, "Thomas, you still doubt." And this is found at the end of every gospel. And so he told Thomas, "Touch me here," where he was speared by the lance. And Thomas touched, and he fell to his knees and said, "My Lord and my God." That is what Thomas said.
Praise the
Lord. To prove, and praise God for this. So Thomas proved, and he was the doubting Thomas that we use as an allegory. And this is another allegory of the Bible. Jesus says at the right hand of a father. It means the right hand of the authority of the Lord. The only way to the Lord is through his son, Jesus Christ. He who does not have the son does not have the father. Amen. And this is what Yahya and the Muslims have been blinded to because of Allah's lie. But remember, Allah is Al-Makkah, the greatest of all deceivers. It is Allah's job, who is Satan in the Bible, to deceive the Muslims, to let them not accept the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ, to accept a stupid pagan ritual of kissing a black stone and believing that this black stone will absorb their sin. And that is why that stone has been black, that it was white as pure before Abraham and the sin of the world from the time of Adam. These lies, these polytheistic lies of people that worship many gods. Yahya, you have been deceived, and I call on you. I have an Arabic gospel, a New Testament.
No.
You speak Arabic better than English. So this is what I will give you as a gift. Yeah, you have one already.
I have tried to give the gospel.
I will explain Allah is the best deceiver.
Yes,
if you don't mind.
Yes. Okay. The best that he said it himself. Yeah, thank you.
Defend him.
The disbeliever, they was planning to kill all the believers who follow Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam.
No, it was to deceive. They plotted against Jesus. That's what the Quran is. I'm teaching you your Quran now, so you don't know your Quran.
You're misquoting your own Quran, Yahya.
The unbelievers plotted, but Allah plotted against them because Allah is the best of all deceivers.
Again,
Sahih International,
again,
I'm plotting your Quran.
Again, you can see, whenever I start to talk, he interrupted
because you don't know your Quran.
Now he wants to deceive
you. And you want to quote our scripture. Sorry, I have no confidence in you.
Now he wants to correct me about the Bible. Okay,
no, I'm correcting you about the Quran as well.
Now he wants to.
So you're sorry. You don't know your Quran, and you don't know your Bible.
You're not sorry.
I am sorry. I told you. We
corrected you on the Bible.
You
changed your Quran.
All your rude manner.
It's not rude. I'm direct.
You are showing how much hatred you have in your heart for the Islam and Muslim and Allah.
I hate Satan's words. So he is deceiving you.
You
hate me. It's my brotherly love for you that has actually made me patiently.
I ask you again.
Avoid the topic for 40 minutes.
Just let me finish any sentence I start. God, the best deceiver, that means God will not guide those who wrongdoer, misleading, transgressor, disbeliever to his path. And he will let them and their disbelief till they die. Then he will cast them in hell fire because they are actually going against God and against his messenger and against word of God. So they are planning evil, and God is the best planner for them. So he lets them deceive themselves and blind them away. Let me finish, please.
I love this. This is passionate.
Again, we come back. You claim that Jesus, peace be upon him, come to die for
Jesus,
the
Prince
sin.
Of peace.
God sent God to die so God can be satisfied, because without the blood there's no salvation. So your God is a bloody God, Dracula. He have no mercy.
So you worship a different God?
He
is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Oh! According to Allah, this is the third Muslim, yes, isn't it?
Because your God is not Allah. Yeah. Your God, yes, is Yahweh. I am here defending
your false God.
Defending my God and your true God. And this is for
my true God.
Your true God. When you say praise the Lord, which Lord you're talking about?
The true God.
The bloody father, the saddest criminal God who sent his son to die for somebody else, who sent his innocent God. So he, your God.
What about Allah sending you to
hell?
Your salvation.
As it become ridiculous.
Yeah, tell you.
Your God sent his innocent son to die for the sin of somebody else. So he is unjust to the son. This is one.
You're wrong. He's not his sent his son.
I didn't finish.
God's son is begotten from God.
Christian, yeah.
No, he said he worships him.
Your God.
We've been going an hour.
Your God, instead of forgiving you. Of forgiving you. You sinner, when you repent, he didn't accept your repentance. He wants the flood for his. Yeah, why you don't understand Christian theology, you don't understand
your own Quran.
Yeah, it's been nearly an hour, man. Come on, tell us what.
Okay, let's conclude it.
Let me conclude.
You know, I don't worship your God, who is bloody, a criminal, sadist, blood trader. I despise your God because he's unjust, he is unmerciful, he is unforgiving.
At least he's been true for that.
I am straightforward.
You're doing more work for Islam.
Yes. And you should repent to my God, who is the God of Jesus. Because my God, when you repent, he accepts your repentance and he forgive you.
Allah is
for
the God
free.
Of Jesus.
Please,
for
go free. On. Have you got anything
I
else?
Finish.
Are
I
you
finish.
Sure?
No, he said Allah is the God of Jesus. He said that Allah is the God of Jesus.
So
you're wrong.
You're saying Allah is the God of Jesus as well.
So Allah is the Father to Jesus.
No,
I told you, Jesus, submit, serve, glorify, praise, fell on his face to worship Almighty God, who is and on
well,
his throne.
You said
we
have a different
Allah.
God, didn't you?
Yeah.
You don't worship Allah.
I mentioned Allah and Genesis
31 times the word Allah in your Bible.
It's not in our Bible.
Yes.
But let me ask you.
Okay, wait, hold on. You've done your part. You had a rant.
Yeah.
So now, as a Christian,
we
spent time, and I'll recap this for the audience that has been lost.
Yeah.
I was on a Christian channel called Islam Critiqued, and I contacted the guy. He does very good theology on Christianity and Islam, and he gives a fair analysis of both. And Side F11 online contacted me and he demanded a debate and we've come here.
Yeah.
When we came here, we said we'll talk about Tawheed and the oneness of God. That's what he said.
And salvation.
Yes.
He has only addressed Tawheed in a very brief description. It was very, very brief. He's given me, he didn't want Brother Hudson to enter this mission, which I found.
I didn't mind.
Hold on. I've given you a chance to talk. Can I have my time? You can keep your poster, that's okay. But let me finish my narrative. So I've gone in and I've tackled all the issues. And even now he's interrupting me and he called me rude. Now, the long suffering that we as Christians have to do when we try and deal with the Islamic dialogue is very, very
strong. Okay, to Hebrew.
It's very, very, how would I say, very challenging at times. Because you're going to hit a wall of ignorance, illiteracy, arrogance, total misconceptions. Because they don't want to learn the truth.
So
they're blinded with Second Thessalonians. So one of the things I want to address, he said that Allah was the best of deceivers at first. But I looked at the context of why Allah said, because the unbelievers plotted against Isa. And Allah's the best of all plotters. So he fooled those people to thinking that he had taken Isa from having the crucifixion. So we Christians are being deceived to by Allah according to him.
Yeah.
But what Saeed, I mean Yahya, has done, he's actually said that we worship a different God,
yeah,
which is
that.
Important. He also said we worship the true God, yeah, which he didn't realize. And when he watches the video, he's actually going to admit to this. Now, I've let him talk. I've tried to be rational with the dialogue. He doesn't understand things like Jesus at the right hand of the Father, which is an allegory. He thinks there are three thrones, but he didn't address that Tawheed is not oneness, but unification. And I've explained to his gods, the Quran is eternal. I've explained that Allah gets prayed to by the faithful. The Kaaba is a stone that absolves sin, which is worship. Jibra. He said they all bow towards it. He's saying it's a unification place. But what he doesn't understand is the word worship means veneration. So if you're worshiping an object, that is an idol. So if you worship a black stone and say it takes away your sin, it makes it a god. It doesn't matter whether the stone moves or not.
Right.
It is still an object. So if I took a black stone in my hand and I said, this is from the Kaaba, that means you can bend towards it. Because if I took a lump out of the Kaaba, now the Quran is eternal, making it also a god, and Muhammad is worshipped by the Muslims. So we didn't address the Tawheed or the unification of what he's doing. He said salvation is believing in the oneness of Allah.
That's it.
But the Bible tells us in James that even the devils believe in one God and they tremble. So believing in one God is not the key to salvation.
Exactly.
The key to salvation is believing that Christ died on the cross, resurrected, and paid for our sin, becoming born again, being baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then following the commandments.
Yeah.
And those commandments are, love thy neighbor as thyself, worship the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. And under those two commandments, for the commandments of the prophets, those commandments are not found in the Quranic narrative. But he has now been the third Muslim in the last 2 weeks to admit that they have a different God. So we call on the Islamic audience. This book, the Holy Bible, the King James Version, is authored by 40 prophets. Moses made the first 5 books, including the book of Job, which was before Moses, but he is the author of that book. 40 prophets over 3,500 years. Are you going to believe this book, or are you going to believe the Quran, one man's testimony?
One man's testimony.
And the book was brought up centuries after he passed away.
Yeah.
It's a contradictory book that talks about flat earth theory.
Yeah.
It's a contradictory book that tells you that Jesus didn't die, even though the Romans accounted that Jesus was crucified.
Yeah.
The Christians account and historians' account. So Allah is not our God.
Nah.
It's not the true God.
No
Another
way.
Muslim has admitted this.
Yeah.
I think we're not going to get any more rhetoric.
That's
I thank you. Please look at all the Christian channels, so-called films. Thank you once again. You've told these Muslims, do not argue with the people of the book. I've said, do not argue with an evangelist using a Christian method. Why? Because if you argue with the people of the book, the prophet learned this lesson himself. We know our scripture. You don't. And you refuse to read the scripture, and the reason is because the Spirit of the Lord is not with you. That's what gives understanding of the scripture. It's not reading it as if you're reading a dictionary.
Yeah.
That will not work. But with the Quran, you have an exegesis in tafsir and hadith. So any layman can read if they look at the word. So Yahya, unfortunately, I think we have to come to a conclusion. I'd like you to give your farewell. You can go on another rant. You've already done enough damage for your religion, but go ahead.
No, that's fine.
Please address Islam critique, because we have to put the link in his video to remind that we did have our debate, and he will see it at the appropriate time.
Okay, look, don't make it long.
I'm
not going to make it long. Actually, I already said what I have to say, and as the brother here, I call him brother, even brother in humanity. He said, Allah is Shaitan. You can find out, open any Arabic Bible, and you will say that Allah is the God. And regarding, I don't understand
your
contradiction.
I
didn't interrupt, so have some respect for yourself.
You put a post across me.
I put it, but I didn't say anything. As I said, I will upload as well on Islam Critic the contradiction in your Bible, which is so many, and I will upload again about your God, that he's a bloody sadist God, and I hope that anyone who listened to me check the reference I already give from the Bible, even if he accused me of not understanding it. And I understand very well that I'm here to defend Almighty God and tell you Christians that Allah, God, He doesn't need, He doesn't need, does not need blood to forgive. He can forgive as soon as you repent. And as He teach in Ezekiel 18:31, that any soul, only the wicked soul will taste death, will suffer. But anyone who repent and come to God with pure heart and good deed according to God, God will, all his bad deed will be forgotten, will be forgiven. And as I'm addressing myself to you, Yahweh is a false God and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a true God. And this is another subject for another, and I will upload the meaning of Yahweh and how it did derive to come as Yahweh, because the Jew bring it over some Jew. Thank you very much.
I'd like to, very short,
respect Yahya.
You are one of the few true Muslims.
Yeah, we love you. We love you, Yahya, for your honesty.
I will shake you for your honesty. Most of them are apostates.
I would like to say, I'm sorry if I sound rude.
No,
I'm saying it straight away how I understand your religion, which I wish that you consider that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most merciful and just, and not a wicked God who wants somebody innocent to die for.
Can I just make, so this is going to be the closure. He did mention something, I thought it was a key word and I had to respond. He talked about works. Well, this is from Acts chapter 15 verse 11. But we believe that through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even day. So we are saved by the grace of Jesus, our Lord. This is the conclusion. Yeah. So I thank you,
Jesus
is Lord.
Right.
Jesus teaches